I want to jump right into the message this morning, and I'm going to tell you, I'm going to try to stick as closely to my notes as I can, because I told Catherine the other day as I was prepping this and putting it together throughout the week, I said there's really enough information here that I could turn this into like a three-week series or a three-week Bible study. I mean, it could just go and go and go and go. I kept having to go back through my notes and take a little out here and take a little out there, because I realized if I left it all in there, we'd be here till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And I don't want to, I know you'll get hungry. So, and the donuts aren't going to hold you over all the way till 3 in the afternoon. So I didn't want to do that to you. So I've trimmed it down as much as I can and kept all of the good stuff there. But like I said, I'm going to kind of stick to my notes as best as I can, because I know me. And once I get going on something, I can go and go, and especially if there's a lot of information, and then you add a few rabbit trails in there, and you just end up with this big, long thing. So, but today is Palm Sunday. What we celebrate in churches all across the nation as Palm Sunday is the day we celebrate the triumphal entry of Christ into Jerusalem. Jesus is coming into Jerusalem for what will be the last time before his crucifixion, before his death and resurrection. And I'm not going to read the passage. I've got some scriptures I'm going to get to in momentarily, but I'm not going to read the passage of the triumphal entry, except to tell you that you can find that in Matthew chapter 21, Mark chapter 11, Luke chapter 19, and John chapter 12. All four of the Gospels record the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. I am going to tell you basically what's going on here, just in case someone's not familiar with the story. There's a festival, a feast going on in Jerusalem. Thousands and thousands of people have come in from all over, really all over the world, from various nations, various countries, various regions. They've come in to celebrate this feast, this festival, and Jesus and his followers, not just his 12 disciples, but a whole group of followers, are heading into Jerusalem as well. And as they come to the city of Jerusalem, Jesus is riding on a donkey, which is very significant in and of itself, because he is fulfilling an Old Testament prophecy. If you go back into the Old Testament and you find the prophet Zechariah, you will find where he prophesies to Jerusalem, and he says, "Your king will come riding on a donkey." So Jesus is literally fulfilling an Old Testament prophecy by riding on this donkey. It's also a statement of the manner in which he is coming into the city. Back in this time and in this region, if a king was coming to a city, people paid close attention to what the king was riding on, because that told you his intention. If the king was coming to declare war on the city, he naturally rode a war horse. If he was coming in peace, he would come riding on a donkey. The donkey was symbolic of the king coming in peace. So Jesus is fulfilling this prophecy that he is the king coming to Jerusalem, coming to the great city, and he's coming in peace. Now, people hear that Jesus is coming and they're excited. Some of them have heard him speak. Some of them have seen miracles that he's performed. He's just recently raised a man back to life who had been dead for 4 days, dead in the grave for 4 days, raised him back to life. People are still popping about that one. I mean, they're still talking about it. They're still excited about it. Jesus is coming into Jerusalem. And so the people go out to greet him. Many, many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people go out to meet Jesus. And as a show that they are accepting him as their king, coming in as the king, they're taking their coats and they're throwing them on the road before him for the donkey to walk over. Now, this is kind of similar to what we would call our red carpet today. When a dignitary or a famous person, a celebrity arrives somewhere and they roll out the red carpet. This was a very similar concept. They're laying their coats in the street for the donkey to walk across. And then they're taking palm branches. This is why we call it Palm Sunday. They're taking palm branches. They're breaking them off the trees. They're throwing those in the street as well. And they're also waving those in the air. Waving them in the air, and they're shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And then they say, "Even the King of Israel." They name him as their king. They're calling out to him as their king, waving the palm branches, shouting, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. So it's a big celebration. It's a big deal. People are shouting. People are jumping. People are dancing. They're waving the palm branches. They're throwing their coats in the street. Jesus is riding in on a donkey. It's one big party going on in Jerusalem. There's only one problem with this whole picture. There's a problem with this. You say, how can there be a problem with this? People are praising Jesus. Here comes the Messiah. Here comes the King. They're having a good old time welcoming him into the city. How can there be a problem here? Here's the problem. The problem was they were celebrating the wrong thing. They were celebrating the wrong thing. Wait, aren't they celebrating Jesus? Yes, but for the wrong reason. You see, we find this in the very, we find this problem embedded in the very verbiage that they use, the very words that they use to welcome Jesus. That first word that you'll see there, if you read again in Matthew 21, Mark 11, Luke 19, and John 12, if you read in those accounts, the very first word that they begin to shout is Hosanna. The word Hosanna, we kind of use it as a word of praise. You know, we sing songs, Hosanna, Hosanna, you know. We kind of equate it to hallelujah. But the word Hosanna literally means, in a straight up translation, it means save us, save us. Now that sounds right, doesn't it? We need Jesus to save us. We need the Messiah, the King of Kings, the Son of God, to save us from our sins. Yes, that is absolutely correct. The problem was the Jewish people of that day welcoming Jesus into the city of Jerusalem were not crying out for him to save them from their sins. They wanted him to save them from the rule of the Romans. They wanted him to save them from this tyrannical government that was over them, this nation who had taken over, who had enslaved them. They weren't looking for salvation from their sins. They were looking for salvation from Rome. We find this continued in the very fact of what we call this today, Palm Sunday, the very fact that they were waving palm branches in the air while they cried out, Hosanna. You see, the palm branch was a symbol of the Maccabees. You say, what's the Maccabees? Is that like a Big Mac at McDonald's or something? I mean, what's up with that? The Maccabees were a Jewish revolutionary group, kind of like a militia, if you will. They were Jewish freedom fighters. And just a few years before, this had nothing to do with Rome per se, but a few years before, the Maccabees, they were actually a family. Their last name was Maccabee. So they called the movement the Maccabees or the Maccabeans. The Maccabees led a revolution, a very bloody, all-out, full-scale battle, war, whatever you want to call it, in the nation, in that region. And so they were freedom fighters. They were a militia of sorts. And there were still pockets of freedom fighters fighting against Rome. There were still small bands of militia who were fighting against the nation of Rome, the rule of Rome. So when they're crying out, Hosanna, save us, and they're waving these palm branches, the palm branches weren't just this great, oh, hallelujah, you know, symbol of, oh, glory to Jesus, wave the branches, he's coming in. They're actually sending him a signal. They're giving him a coded message, if you will. They're calling him their king, and they're saying, save us from Rome. Lead us in a revolution. Call us to take up arms. We are ready to fight. We are ready to shed blood. We are ready to take up arms against Rome. Do what the Maccabees did. Lead us in a revolution. You see, they're celebrating, but they're celebrating the wrong thing. They're celebrating for the wrong reasons. They're celebrating because they want Jesus to lead them in a revolution. Now, just a few days later, some of the very same people who had been shouting Hosanna and waving palm branches, they're now tearing their clothes and screaming, crucify him, crucify him. Just a few days later, about the same person, about Jesus. They go from Hosanna, save us, you're the King of Israel, to crucify him. What would cause them to change their minds so quickly? What would cause them to go from Hosanna to crucify him in a matter of a few days? Well, it became obvious to them that Jesus was not there to lead the revolution that they wanted him to lead. It became obvious to them that Jesus was not there to call them to take up arms, to begin a bloody revolution against Rome. And so they very quickly turned on him. I'm sure we all have experiences with people who have turned just like that. One moment they're nice, one moment they're patting you on the back, one moment they're shaking your hand, they're hugging your neck, they're calling you sweetheart, and the next minute they're clawing your eyeballs out. I mean, it just like that, just turns just like that. It's sadly, it's part of human nature. We can turn so quickly. They turned on Jesus because they realized he didn't come to do what they wanted him to do. He didn't come to do what they expected him to do. And we find the message that Jesus is not here for revolution. He's not here for war. We find it spelled out explicitly in his own words in John chapter 18, verses 33 through 36. John chapter 18, verses 33 through 36. Jesus has been arrested. He's been falsely accused. He's been brought before Pilate, who is the Roman governor of the area. The reason the Jews had to take Jesus before the Roman governor is because part of the Roman law stated that Jews could not put someone to death on their own. It had to be done by the Romans. So they take him to Pilate, and we take up reading in John 18, verse 33. It says, "So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, 'Are you the King of the Jews?' Jesus answered, 'Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?' Pilate answered, 'Am I a Jew? Your own nation and chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?' Jesus answered, 'My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not of this world.'" Jesus makes it very clear he's not here to lead a revolution. He said, if I was here, if my kingdom was of this world, if I was here for what you think I'm here for, my servants would have been fighting. I would have led a revolution. We would have taken up arms. But that's not why I'm here. That's not what I came for. He says, my kingdom is not of this world. Now, what exactly is Jesus saying with this statement? What exactly is Jesus saying when he says, my kingdom is not of this world? Well, first of all, he's making a point that there are two different kingdoms. My kingdom is not of this world. There are two different kingdoms, and they are opposed to each other. They clash with each other. They don't get along. They don't exist in harmony. They butt up against each other. We're talking about the kingdom of God and the kingdom of man. Jesus is making it very clear there's two different kingdoms to distinguish between, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of man. The second thing that Jesus is bringing out here is he's saying, my kingdom does not operate the way your kingdom does. Okay, there's two different kingdoms and they're opposed to each other. And just so, Jesus is saying, just so we're clear on this, my kingdom doesn't work the way your kingdom does. My kingdom doesn't look how your kingdom looks. My kingdom doesn't taste or sound or smell or look like your kingdom looks. My kingdom is not like yours. What he's saying is this. He's saying your kingdom feels threatened, so it takes up arms. Your kingdom wants to expand, it goes to war. Your kingdom rejects truth in favor of lies. He's saying your kingdom feeds off of fear, anger, bitterness, and jealousy. But my kingdom doesn't operate this way. My kingdom doesn't look like that. My kingdom doesn't feel like that. My kingdom doesn't sound like that. He's saying there are two different kingdoms. They're opposed one to another. And my kingdom is nothing like your kingdom. Now, if we're not careful, we can make the same mistake that the Jews of 2,000 years ago made when they were welcoming Jesus into Jerusalem. We can make the same mistake they did. And that's this: we can make the wrong assumption about what Jesus is talking about here. We can make the wrong assumption about what he means when he's talking about kingdoms. You see, 2,000 years ago, when they were welcoming Jesus into Jerusalem, they assumed that his focus was on the kingdom of man. They assumed that he had come to set them free from Rome. They assumed that he had come to lead a coup, to lead a revolution. They assumed that his focus was on the kingdom of man. We, on the other hand, tend to go to the other side of the coin. We tend to consider Jesus' focus to be solely on the kingdom of God. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, wouldn't his focus be on the kingdom of God? We make an assumption. We make an assumption that his focus is entirely on the kingdom of God, and he doesn't care 2 cents about the kingdom of man. He doesn't care at all about the kingdom of man. It's a kingdom to be destroyed. It's a kingdom to be defeated. It's a kingdom to be done away with. So 2,000 years ago, they thought he was focusing on the kingdom of man. Today, we tend to think he's focusing solely on the kingdom of God. Both assumptions are wrong. You see, it's easy to understand what the Jews were thinking. They were tired of Rome ruling over them. They were tired of the oppression of Rome. They wanted to be set free. They wanted to be set free. Now, it's easy to understand that. But when we look at our own assumptions that we can make, where we get off, where we get it wrong, where we make the wrong assumption, is believing that he's only focused on the kingdom of God. In other words, we think that the work of Jesus, or many people think, I don't want to say everyone, but many people tend to think that the work of Jesus is only about getting me to heaven. That's all it's about. Get me out of this world, get me out of here, get me out of the kingdom of man, and get me to heaven one day. Get me there one day. The focus is completely on the spiritual versus the natural. We tend to think that God wants to destroy the kingdom of man. We think that he wants to do away with anything to do with this world, with the life that we live now. But that's a wrong assumption. 2,000 years ago, it was a wrong assumption that he was solely focused on the kingdom of man. Today, it's a wrong assumption if we assume that he's solely focused on the kingdom of God. So, which kingdom is Jesus focused on? What is it that draws his attention? What is it that he's concerned about? Well, the answer is, it's both kingdoms. His focus is on both kingdoms. His concern is for both kingdoms. You see, we have to go back to the very beginning to understand how this works out, to understand how this unfolds. You have to go all the way back to Genesis. I'm not going to read from the book of Genesis, but in Genesis you will find that God creates everything. Everything. He creates the galaxies, universes, stars, suns, moons. He creates the earth. He creates life on earth, trees and vegetations, animals. There's water, there's sky, there's light, there's air. He creates people, he creates human beings. God creates everything. And then he places man in charge of planet Earth. And he says, you're to tend it, you're to care for it, you're to take dominion over it. You are to spread out and cover the entire planet. Now, God, we know that God placed man in the Garden of Eden, but it was never God's intention for man to stay in the Garden of Eden for eternity. He tells him, be fruitful and multiply. Take dominion over, not the garden, but the earth. If man was to be fruitful and multiply, they're going to fill up the garden pretty soon. They're going to have to leave the borders of that garden and begin to spread out over the planet. This was God's plan. This was God's intention. It wasn't for them to stay in the garden. It was for them to spread the garden over the entire planet. It was for them to continue to expand the borders of that garden as they took dominion over the earth until the entire earth was being tended by mankind, was being cared for by mankind. And then God's ultimate plan was that his presence would dwell with man on planet earth for eternity. God never intended for there to be earth over here and heaven over here, and God is always in heaven and man is always on earth, and God just kind of comes and visits us every once in a while, or, you know, when we die, he takes us away from earth and over to heaven over here, but the two stay separate. That was never God's intention. His intention was for was to bring heaven and earth together. Once man had completed their mission of taking dominion over the planet, heaven and earth were to be joined together, and God was going to dwell with his people forever, in the midst of his people for eternity. Now, if I can change the language on that narrative just a little bit to give you a slightly different view of what's going on here with creation. It's as though God has created innumerable galaxies and universes. He's created all of these things, and then right in the middle of it all, he creates this planet called Earth. And if you will, Earth is like a cosmic temple. Now, when I say cosmic, don't start thinking all New Agey stuff. I'm not getting all weird here. I just mean cosmic in the sense of the whole big thing. Earth is like the temple, okay? We know that everything that God has given us on the earth is a reflection of something in heaven, in God's kingdom. If you read in Revelation and some of the Old Testament prophets where they saw visions of heaven, you read about the throne room of God, you'll see that the temple that God gave Moses and the Israelites instructions to build is laid out just like God's throne room in his kingdom in heaven. You've got the outer courts, you've got the inner courts, you've got the holy place, you've got the holy of holies. You, in the temple on the earth, they had the showbread and the menorah, the great candle, the lamp with the oil and the wicks. And these things all represented different things in heaven, different things in God's kingdom. And so just as we have a temple on earth, it represents a temple in heaven. The earth itself is essentially a temple where God placed man as a royal priesthood to offer sacrifices of praise and worship and obedience unto God in that temple. And our job was to care for the temple, to take care of this temple, worshiping the one whose temple it was. And eventually, once we fulfilled the mission that he gave us, then his presence would come and fill the temple. Just a slightly different way of looking at it. His presence would come and cover the earth. The scripture talks about the earth being covered with the glory of God as the waters cover the sea. His presence would come and cover the earth. His presence would come and fill the temple forevermore. The problem is, man rebelled against God. The priesthood rebelled against its God. We started a coup, so to speak. We attempted a coup. We attempted a rebellion in the great cosmic temple, if you will, in the planet that God gave us and said, take dominion in my name. Rule this planet in my name. Take care of this planet in my name. Live as a reflection of me. And rather than do that, we began a rebellion with our sin, with our sinful nature. And the kingdom, what was intended to be a united kingdom, was divided. Do you see where we're going with this? Jesus is talking about two different kingdoms, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of man. But we're seeing from the very beginning, all the way back in the book of Genesis, we're seeing that from the very beginning, it was never intended for there to be two kingdoms. It was intended for there to be one kingdom joined together, one kingdom together in unity. But when man rebels, he causes a chasm. He causes a division in the kingdom. He causes a split in the kingdom. Man is no longer a priest of God, ministering in his great temple with acts of worship and obedience, but he is now a rebel fighting to wrest control over his own kingdom. Man wants his own kingdom. He wants his own rule. He wants his own say. This goes on for hundreds, hundreds and hundreds of years, and then along comes Jesus with all of his talk about the kingdom of God. If you read the scripture, he talks constantly. Jesus talks constantly about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God. He's describing the kingdom of God. He's telling them how to find the kingdom of God, how to discover the kingdom of God, where the kingdom of God is, how the kingdom of God operates. Kingdom, kingdom, kingdom. Because Jesus did not come to play into the kingdom of man. He came to bring the kingdom of God and the kingdom of man back together again. I'm getting a little ahead of myself on that there. But Jesus came to bring those kingdoms back together. In Matthew chapter 6 and in Luke chapter 11, Matthew chapter 6 and Luke chapter 11, Jesus is teaching his followers how to pray. And there's one phrase in the prayer that he teaches them that stands out. And it applies directly to what we're talking about today. And that's this phrase right here. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So the kingdoms have been divided. The kingdom of God is in heaven. The kingdom of man is on earth. But Jesus is not saying, Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Destroy the kingdom of man and the earth. So that only your kingdom exists. He doesn't say that. He doesn't say wipe out all of these sinful men, these humans who have rebelled against you, who have walked away and turned their back on you. Destroy them, wipe them out so that only your kingdom reigns. He doesn't say that. What does he say? Your kingdom come. Bring heaven to earth. Bring the kingdoms back together again. This was the reason Jesus came. And this is why they crucified him. Because they did not understand that he had come to bring unification between the two kingdoms. They were solely focused on the kingdom of man. All they could think about was getting out from under the control of the Romans. And when Jesus wasn't there to do what they expected, they turned on him. And so many people today misunderstand the mission that Jesus came for, that Jesus gave us as his followers, because we get our focus in the opposite direction. We put our focus solely on heaven. It's all about just getting to heaven, just getting out of here and getting away from this and getting to heaven. And we fail to realize that when we completely neglect the kingdom of man or the kingdom of this world, we're not fulfilling the mission that Jesus gave us, because his mission is to bring them together again. His mission is to bring them into unity again. Jesus did not come to play into the kingdom of man, nor did he come to destroy it, but he came to invade it with the kingdom of God. He came to reinstate God's original plan for one united kingdom. The fullness of this is evident in the book of Revelation. You find this a lot in the book of Revelation. In fact, Revelation chapter 11 and verse 15 says this. It's talking about kingdoms here. It says, then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, listen, the kingdom of the world, or the kingdom of man, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. It doesn't say anything about destroying one kingdom in favor of another. It says this kingdom has been joined together. The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our God. It's become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. It's talking about one day in the future, these two kingdoms will be reunited once again. This is God's purpose. This is God's plan. This is the focus that Jesus came with on both kingdoms. He didn't come and just tell people how good God was. He came and healed physical diseases. Physical disease has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. It has everything to do with the kingdom of man. But Jesus was bringing healing into the kingdom of man. He was bringing restoration into the kingdom of man. When he raised dead bodies back to life again, He was bringing healing and restoration into the kingdom of this world. He was saying that when these two kingdoms come together, look, this is what's going to happen. Death has no more power. Sickness has no more power. Sin has no more power, because the kingdom of this world will become the kingdom of our Lord and of His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. In Revelation chapter 21, one of my absolute favorite chapters in the whole Bible. I love the whole Bible. I love everything in the Word of God. But Revelation 21 is one of my favorites, because it tells us what's going to happen in the future. And it describes a scene where there is a new heaven and a new earth. Now, we talked about this a while back in a series that we did, talking about God making all things new. And we discover that new earth doesn't mean totally and completely new, but it means renewed. God is not going to destroy this planet that He created. When Scripture talks about fire and things that will consume, it's talking about consuming the sinfulness from this earth. It's talking about consuming evil and purging the earth through fire. If God were to take His creation and just throw it away and destroy it and start all over again, then guess what? Satan won. If God throws it away and says, nah, I'm just going to make a whole new planet, I'm just going to start all over again, Satan won. He got God to destroy a creation that He made. And what did God say about His creation in Genesis? Every time He created something, what did He say? It is good. It is good. Now, it's been tainted by sin, but the fire of God is going to purify that sin. It's going to purge the sin from the world. So when John in Revelation 21 says he sees a new heaven and a new earth, he's talking about they have been renewed. They have been redeemed. They have been purged from sin, from wickedness, and from evil. So he sees this renewed earth, and then he sees the new Jerusalem coming out of heaven to the earth. Literally, this is a bridge, if you will, between heaven and earth. The New Jerusalem is coming down out of heaven. Notice it does not stay in heaven. It comes out of heaven and it comes down to the earth. It settles on the earth. What is literally happening here is the kingdom of God and the kingdom of man are being joined together once more. They're coming back into unity once more. Because it goes on to say, if you read it in Revelation 21, it doesn't say that God sends the New Jerusalem down from heaven and it just stays on the earth and heaven's over here and earth is over here. The kingdom of God's over here and the kingdom of man is over here. But it says that God will dwell among His people. It doesn't say He's going to bring His people to dwell among them or with Him. It says He is going to come and dwell with His people. It doesn't mean that He abandons heaven, but He brings the two kingdoms together. God's kingdom comes into contact with man's kingdom. God comes to dwell among His people with the New Jerusalem as His capital, where His throne will sit on planet Earth, where God will dwell with us forever and ever and ever. And we will be restored to that position of a royal priesthood, tending that cosmic temple, taking care of the renewed planet, taking dominion over the planet, tending it, caring for it as a reflection of God, the Creator, of Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's talking about the reunification. John is talking about the reunification of these two kingdoms, bringing them back together once again. As we enter, I'm telling you, there's so many different ways I could just keep going and branching off on this, but I'm gonna wrap it up here. And when I say I'm gonna wrap it up, I mean I'm literally gonna wrap it up. I'm gonna read what's on my notes here and I'm done. No rabbit trails, okay? As we go into this Easter season, we celebrate His death as a means to forgiveness of sin, and we celebrate His resurrection, meaning that we will be resurrected and we will one day live for eternity. But listen, we celebrate His death as a way for us to have a personal relationship with God. His resurrection as a way for that relationship to be eternal, for it to last forever. But listen, the work that Jesus did on Calvary, I want you to think about this on Good Friday. When Friday rolls around this week, we're contemplating the death of Jesus, the sacrifice that he made for us, the work that he did for us. I want you to think about this. The work that Jesus did 2,000 years ago is about more than just us having a personal relationship with God. That's a big part of it. I'm not knocking the personal relationship. Don't get me wrong. Don't leave here and say, Pastor Joe said we don't have to have a personal relationship with God. It's not what I'm saying. I'm saying it's about more than just a personal relationship with God. It's about the renewal of all things. It's about the redemption of everything that God created. It's about making all things new. Jesus said it. He said, behold, I make all things new. He said, I'm redeeming, I'm renewing all things. It's about more than just a personal relationship. Think about that this Friday. Definitely think about your personal relationship with God. Be thankful for your personal relationship with God. Grow in your personal relationship with God. But remember that it's about more than just me. It's about all of creation. Scripture says all of creation groans waiting for that day when all things are made new, when all things are complete, when all things are renewed. It's about all of creation. It's about that cosmic temple being restored. It's about the cosmos being redeemed and being restored and being brought back to God. 2,000 years ago, they made a wrong assumption about why Jesus had come. Let's not make the same mistake today and make the wrong assumptions. Let's not focus just on one part over here. Just what I think this is what it's all about over here. Let's remember that God is after everything. God is after renewal. Now, does that mean that every single person will be saved and give their life to Jesus? No, it doesn't. Sadly, it doesn't. I'm not preaching universalism here. When I talk about the redemption of all things, when I talk about the renewal of all things, I'm talking about the renewal of God's creation. As far as people go, it's to whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord. Unfortunately, not everyone's going to do that. But guess what? God is after every last person. If he can get them, he's after them. He would that none would perish. He's going after every single person that he can. So let's not get our attention just on one area. Let's remember he's after the whole. He's not after one piece of the pie. He's after the whole thing. He's after the whole thing. God is after renewing all things. And we can be a part of that. But here's the problem, and I am closing with this right here. If we are solely focused on the kingdom of heaven to the point that we neglect the kingdom of man, as messed up as it might be, we might want to, just, I don't even want to fool with the kingdom of man. All the lying and the cheating and the stealing and the perversion and the just the grossness that's out there. I don't want anything to do with it. I just want to go off and live in a little commune somewhere and grow some vegetables and have a couple of cows and be by myself and just get away from all this. But if we do that, are we helping anyone in the kingdom of this world? Are we making a difference at all in the kingdom of this world? And that's what can happen if we get our focus solely on the Jews 2,000 years ago were solely focused on the kingdom of man. They didn't care about the kingdom of God. They didn't care about righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. They didn't care about those things. They just cared about their physical needs right there in front of them. But if all we focus on is just getting away from that, just give me the kingdom of heaven and I don't want to worry about all this, then we're not fulfilling the Great Commission to go into all the world and share the gospel with every creature. We have to realize God is after both kingdoms because his plan and his intention is to bring them together into one kingdom. One perfectly unified kingdom. And one day the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdom of our God and of his Christ and his Savior. Father, I thank you this morning for your